Ladies and gentlemen, how you all doing? This is Con Ulrich coming to you with some more Company of Heroes 2 1v1 action on Faymonville Approach. Yet again, this is going to be a 1v1, as I already stated, between the blue-trunked forces of Jove up here in the north, playing the Wehrmacht, and down here, his opponent, spawning up in those lovely, lovely red trunks, it is going to be the Soviet forces of Panzer Grenadier Angreifen. He has decided already he does not want to go for the support weapon company. He's going to be picking up a special rifle command instead. Will we possibly be seeing a penal build out of this Russian player? Only time will definitely tell. Taking a quick look at commanders before things get too far, Panzer Grenadier bring into the fray terror tactics, shock rifle frontline tactics, and guard motor coordination tactics. Bulletins are not that surprising. Maybe the only thing you don't usually see is a AT grenade ability has a little bit more range, and that's just positive overall. His opponent, of course, Jove, is bringing mobile defense, mechanized assault, and elite troops. So three kind of standard ones coming out for the Big J. And Panzer Grenadier giving us a nice, very varied commander decision. Now, up here in the north, we're going to see already a sandbag fighting position has gone down. Are we going to see a machine gun? Yes, the machine gun's setting up over here, going to put some fire down on top of these combat engineers. And we're going to see the MG do what it does best, suppress and prevent this other wire from going up. And indeed, you see the combat engineers are suppressed, not pushed back just yet. Get this wire up right here, this will frustrate any attempt by the Germans. Oh, never mind, here we go. So another burst of fire should get them nice and pinned down. No, green cover, never mind, folks. So Soviets are already going to get themselves their fuel point into easy, easy supply. And they're calling in a scout sniper team. That's an interesting decision. You don't often see those guys these days. And aren't they lovely looking in their dashing, dashing summer uniforms here. Going in and out of cover, going in and out of sight. Meanwhile, Jove calling in a couple of squads of Grenadiers. The Grenadiers moving around the central portions of the map. Well, one to the center, one to the south, finally connecting this fuel point. And the scout snipers are slowly going to bleed away this machine gun. Luckily, I would say for the machine gun, it's not so easy to get unobstructed line of sight on that house. And you can see the scout snipers trying to stay in cover and yet being able to get shots off. This is not an easy task, no sir. Germans, of course, have lost a couple of tickets already. The Soviets have making a very big push to pick up that early VP in the north. But these Grenadiers are going to possibly pressure and curve around these conscripts. Oh, okay, so the machine gun putting down the base of fire from the south. Grenadiers coming in from the north and definitely preventing them. I would say, oh, no, not going to get them suppressed. That would have been a beautiful, beautiful opportunity to manage to suppress them right in this area here. But instead, it's going to be close quarter fighting right here. And it's kind of a crapshoot whoever's going to win. It could go either direction, really. And a redeployed machine gun does see those conscripts beaten and pushed back. They only have one bear model left. We're going to see him go down and retreat. No, not quite yet. The Germans, by their own particular case, are going to be bringing in my mind, shockingly enough, their own sniper. This is a very, very uncommon decision. Meanwhile, the scout sniper team for the Soviets is starting to get their own headshots, poking in and taking out a couple of models here and there. Question is, will the sniper be focused strictly on counter-sniping, or what will the deal be on that occasion? Kind of want to follow this for a little bit, because this could be quite exciting. Very enemy at the gates. One thing worth noting is that this sniper... This sniper is able to move in and out of open territory through camouflage. Wow, I'm having a really hard time saying this. Let me try this again there, folks. This guy right here does not have to be in cover to be camouflaged. That's an important thing to remember. What's more, we're going to see actually these combat engineers being caught out by pioneers. And luckily for him, these grenadiers moving away to the south instead of really pressuring the activity. Snipers now realize that they're going to get themselves a little caught out. Grenadiers pushing around to the south force them into a very, very rapid retreat. And hopping into this garrison right here might do put just a tiny bit of pressure onto these conscripts. Never mind, I lied. A fair bit of pressure happening here, sandwiching him from both flanks. Probably going to take out at least one model on retreat. I don't know. And in the meantime, this sniper, yep, this sniper is purely here for counter-sniping purposes. And any moment, we'll see these guys troop on forward and take a headshot for their trouble. Question is whether Joe's paying attention enough for this. He does tend to micro an awful lot. In the meantime, oh, here it comes. No, not quite yet, not quite yet. I kind of want to see this whole sniper battle happening here. Oh, he's got to see them. He's got to see them. Here comes a headshot. Pop lock and drop it. Going after those Grenadiers. Yep, one shot goes in. Both guys decide to retreat. There you go. So yeah, that sniper is there just to mitigate the effectiveness of that scout sniper team. Panzer Grenadier Angreifen is going to call on one of those new squads of penals. Now remember, folks, they don't have that whole flamethrower anymore. It's going to be those PTRS rifles, and you see that happening right now. Those things are rather deadly when used on innocent infantry. Well, what's more, they have this kind of amazing ability that the more people they lose, the better they get. Very, very unorky of them, if you ask me. Now, Jove just finished his Lechte Mechanized Company. Sniper, in the meantime, getting a couple more headshots before the scout sniper is redeploy. And this guy's got to pull out now. There he goes. He has managed to decap this fuel point away from the Soviets, though. Jove is calling in at half-track. It's an uncommon decision. Don't tend to see that very often. But the mobility and first flushing out and getting rid of the scout sniper team, if he can dive deep enough with that, it could be quite, quite good. And he's going even further with it. He's going for this flame projector, so things are absolutely deadly. Of course, at this point, he is completely and totally forfeiting the opportunity to reinforce in the field. And indeed, transportation is going to be a lot harder when you have flame tanks on the side of your half-track instead of legitimate troop carrying capability. But let's watch the squad right here melt as soon as these guys get brought on in. And first flame projector fire should be coming right about now. So, burninating away, this guy's going to get pulled back at the risk of probably taking another model or two on retreat. Not quite yet, but don't count him out. He's chasing him away, and those penals are not back at base. They're only pulling back right now. So, can we see a squad drop right here? It's entirely possible. That's one. And do I hear number two? Number two. Do I see number two? No, not quite, but he's going to put some good damage over here on these penals, even as the penals move in, to put some damage in on that retreating half-track. Now, the machine gun, in the meantime, has been forced out of this upper house, once again, a consequence of that scout sniper squad. In the meantime, the sniper over here is completely out of position to combat that. That's going to be a standard thing, unfortunately, for a little bit of time yet. Oh, I guess the conscripts finally did go down. With the sniper trying to pressure these scout snipers into a retreat without getting caught out himself, because that would be very, very bad. Conscripts are chasing on in, trying to get an AT grenade off, but no, not managing to do that. But we are going to finally see a support from Compania coming out, so that could mean that we'll see a Zisk gun soon enough. Sniper in the meantime, Jove is very good with his sniper micro. He seems to know instinctually when his opponent's snipers can be, in fact, on the map. And we're seeing him shift over here to pick on these penals a little bit more, even as his Grenadiers cut off this supply point to the north, paying for it with a couple of their lives, but it is still worth the blood, sweat, and tears. Of course, in the meantime, we are seeing our first Stars of Veterancy coming onto this map, both in this now very, very alone Grenadier, as well as the Pioneer squads, but both players are being rather cagey about how they're engaging here. Scott Sniper, surprisingly enough, one of the first people with veterancy on the Soviet side. The other one, these conscripts right here. Thankfully, the penal troops are not anywhere near that first vet squad. That first veterancy level, rather, excuse me. Because once again, that to the last man is a devastating, ability. And rather passive, for that matter, too. Now, first Maxim is coming onto the field. The support company has been called in. So I'm wondering if we're going to see a push by the Soviets to bring in a Zisk gun. No, he's calling in a second scout sniper team. And where is this scout sniper? Where was her ally? I don't know where her other sniping buddy was, but it appears that it has not been able to make it back to see the Rodina one more time. Now, we are going to see this half-track deploy to the south, And luckily for it, it's been able to have this attendant squad of Soviet conscripts getting suppressed by the machine gun finally into this godhouse in the exact middle of this map. Without that happening, excuse me, a quick oorah with an AT grenade and then followed up by these PTRSs could have been more than enough to take them out. Now, I am a little bit concerned for the German sniper. There are two Soviet sniper teams now out on the map, and they are quite good at getting that damage down. I'll try to keep an eye on that. So he's going to do some tanking with one so he can take a shot with the other one? I don't know, but you can see all four snipers hanging around the same part of the map. We're also going to see in the south, though, penal troops getting caught up by a machine gun, and now a German mortar is on the field. Maximus is barely out of range. If he gets a couple of bursts of fire, this guy's going to carve to pieces here. Shockingly, he's not firing yet. I'm not entirely sure why. But Jove taking a couple more shots here and there. Scout snipers. Yeah, this is clearly what this is. It's going to be unmasking and then taking the headshot with the other one. Question is, can people at this mortar team, can they drop enough rounds? Get some lucky hits onto the scout snipers. And I'm telling you, folks, I don't know if that's going to be the case. We will see, finally, as this gun coming out from... There we go. Okay, so he's just going to start picking on this machine gun as much as possible. He knows there's two of them here. Bam, that's one headshot down. Machine gun's going to find another one out? No, not quite yet. But the scout snipers, that was a bad idea to go and start firing on this machine gun. I understand why, but I don't think that was the best opportunity for them. Now, this MG will be forced back. It might even get picked off. No, it won't. On retreat, I lie right there as the Maximus forced into a rather rapid retreat by itself. And interestingly, Jove, I don't think, is teched up to battle phase 2. No, he is not. German mortar, in the meantime, getting away some of this cover. Probably a good thing in the long run. While the Grenadiers in the south are trying to push forward to maybe recap this fuel point away from the Soviets, and Panzer Grenadier is going to go for the shock rifle frontline tactic, so that IS-2 and the KV-8 could be an exceedingly terrifying late-game combination for the Red Army. But for the time being, he's actually being outfought quite a bit. He's down about 50 tickets, although he is going to get some of that ticking back in his favor. And in terms of veterancy, he is down quite a lot as well. Machine gun going to be able to put some fire onto his conscripts and maybe suppress these combat engineers? No, not quite. Half-track, in the meantime, diving on in, trying to find one of these scout sniper teams, has not done so. Deflected a little bit by the PTRSs of this penal troop right here. Now, shocked to see we're not seeing any kind of teching up from Panzer Grenadier. But then I'm realizing with the late-game KV-8s or the mid-game KV-8s and the late-game IS-2, that's not as great of a priority for him. It's, you know, just a couple of VPs away, and he pick up a rather effective, I would say, flamethrower tank. And what's more, this guy right here is exceedingly expensive. You can see that 230 fuel. It's been 40 minutes into the game, and he only has enough fuel for it now. We're going to see a dive right here. This could be... either is exceedingly dangerous and dumb dive, or this could be perfect, and I don't know which. Conscript squad does go down, so that's a bit of good work done there already. I don't know, the Ziska might get a shot off. Yes, it does. There goes the half track, and that's just a shame to see that go down. What's more, this has allowed the Soviets to take a trip cap on this map. So 14 minutes in, we're going to see rough parity in terms of tickets, even before the Germans managed to get anything decapped, let alone recapped. 392 to 387. And I'm really, really waiting to see who is the first guy to get a later tank onto this field. See, elite troops, every single one of these things is going to allow a later game call-in. And while mobile defense is good for the Austrian reserves, I don't know necessarily why Jove would go that direction. Now, if I'm Jove, I probably would go... excuse me. Tiger Ace is nice. I'd probably go, actually, though, with this mechanized assault doctrine under the circumstances. I don't know my opponents decided to go... Oof. The rather hefty mortar shot right there. I'd rather go, probably, with mechanized assault. Mechanized assault, given those Stugs. That's a kind of a viable opportunity just to kind of nip at everything else to death, especially if it's that rather frustrating KV-8. Sniper going to get a shot off? No, he's not. Both scout sniper teams make it away. Yet again. But okay, we will see the Germans threaten to decap a couple of the middle VP. They are going to take the northern fuel. No, they're not. Never mind. Coming under some PTRS fire, they are quickly encouraged to leave. In the meantime, Panzer Grenadier has now unlocked the incendiary artillery barrage. And this thing, I can tell you from personal experience, is a terrifying piece of commander opportunities. I'm still wondering why Jove has not decided to go up and tech into... No, he finally has that battle phase 2. That's good right there. Will he skip battle phase 2 and go right to 3? I don't know if that's maybe the best option. Now, if I'm him, like I said, I'm probably just going to tech to this, take mechanized assault. I can call in a couple strokes for right now. I'm controlling fuel for the most part. Doing okay with it. Not perfect, but I'm doing okay. Ooh, and these scout snipers are going to find themselves in the middle part of the map. Shot coming out? No shot. So they're going to slide down to the south. And incendiary artillery barrage, where's that going down? Okay, up here to the north. Not accomplishing a whole lot. Support armor core went down, so we're going to see a Panzer IV. So I guess not too surprising. Oh, geez. And that mine that just got placed down by the combat engineers has claimed its first victims. In the meantime, the Grenadier squad has decided to brave it. They've lost a couple of their comrades, but it doesn't seem they are too affected by it. No rifle grenade out here. No, sir. Instead, they're going to take mortar fire. And unluckily for this sniper, and luckily for these scout snipers, I do believe we'll see both squads make it back home. But alrighty, Jove is now going to be going under a 2-1 cap. He's got a 2... There we go. It's just he had a 2-1 in his favor for just a second there. But that's already dropped off in favor of a 1-all cap. It's going to be a 2-1 cap in favor for the Soviets. But the P-4 is coming onto the field. So the question is, will Panzer Grenadier just throw in a couple of KV-8s? He could definitely afford to do it as of right now, but I don't know if that's really the best option for him. We will see this German machine gun inside of this godhouse, but the godhouse is awfully small. It's going to be taking an awful lot of firepower as well. So even while the Zisk gun, though, is going to throw some rounds downrange, we will see a charge of this P4, and it looks like, never mind, there goes the death of that Maxim. Yikes, that was pretty deadly right there. One more round could do it against this... Nope, Zisk gun is going to make it out okay. Another shell or two would be perfect. But no, instead it's going to be... These conscripts encouraging that P4 to back off. Now, Maxim, in the meantime, had been decruised and be recruited under the auspices of that new combat engineer squad, who's been reduced to one model. He's going to pull back rather swiftly. And this sniper right here is really, really unlucky to be this German sniper. Oof. This could be a good push, though, for the Germans. They might be able to beat on this conscript squad quite a bit. Yep, this is going to go really rather well for them. Once again, it's going to catch these Zisk guns out and will allow these Grenadiers to put some really, really great pressure on both sides here. And yep, there's a KV-8, all right. I'm not going to suggest that I called that one, but at the same time, calling that KV-8 in will allow that P4 a playmate. And with the Zisk guns to back up the KV-8, the Soviets should never really lose field presence. Of course, I say that right now as the Germans do have a triple cap, and they are behind a tiny bit. And with the KV-8 on the field, these garrisons are going to be easily pushed aside. And at long last, as well, as she noted, this pack, which had not done anything so far on this map, is going to get himself some true value. Forgive me for missing that. Was it the machine gun? No, I could not say exactly what that was. It just dropped. Oh, it was one of the scout snipers. Did he run across? Was this a mortar? Well, he's dead, all right. Alrighty, so that was surprising enough right there. But the scout snipers might find themselves caught out here KV-8 has not shifted over to the main gun. Indeed, that's only a 45 mil in the first place. So that thing is not going to do much damage to that kind of pop gun. Instead, he's using that to be just that anti-infantry presence. And with a pack gun on the field, he gets really good damage against that. But Scout Sniper Team, one of them is down, and is not the more vetted up one, so that's lucky enough for the Soviets. Nevertheless, 330 to 330, we are bang on ticket for the moment. Are we going to see perhaps a push around a Faust to the side of this rather deadly vehicle? That'd be perfect right now. Grenadiers are taking some firepower, but I think this pack might even get off a second round. No, never mind. If the Germans had any sort of way that dropped indirect fire right here, would be perfect for them. Instead, Jove is going to go for a second P4. And this is not an uncommon thing to see out of Jove. He tends to go for a bit of a heavier Tier 3 presence. To Tier 3 just to denote the support armor core. P4 is definitely comparative to a lot of your Panthers out there. Maybe in the context of this game, at least. Williams, I know what you're going to complain about. In the meantime, we'll see this pack is going to take some damage from from the Scout Sniper Team, but Scout Sniper Team is going to take some losses of its own. In the meantime, we will see Pioneers dueling, I would say, with these PTRSs, as the PTRS penal troops are going after this Sniper. A couple more shots might be able to take them out, but no, the Pioneers encourage them to back away before too much more damage is done. But they need to pull back in turn, otherwise they're going to get picked off by the Soviet snipers. I'm surprised to see as well that it's 23 kills on that already. Ah, oh my gosh, the dual P4s are diving on in, and these Zisk guns are not going to be able to deal with that. A couple of good rounds going downrange, one Zisk gun's going to get set back up, but I don't know if the other one's going to get a chance to do so. No, in the meantime, these P4s are being awfully cagey. They're just going to sit back, relax a little bit. And I'm going to guess the second he sees, yep, anti-tank guns are set up and rounds are going down range. So he's going to take some damage here, that's for sure. But he's not too cowed by it. Might want to be a little more cowed here, as one of his Panzer IVs is going to take a lot of damage, going down to about, what, 15, 18% health? As the PTRS penals are trooping on forwards. And it's one thing that's always kind of bothered me about this game, is that the Americans have HE versus AP. The Soviets have their own version of HE versus AP, maybe not perfect analogs, but nevertheless stuff that can be utilized as it. Germans didn't go into battle just firing iron slugs all over the place. But 22 minutes in, I can't complain about how Jove's immediate prospects are. He's got the army composition to beat his opponent senseless. It's really a question whether or not he's able to do so. We will see a decap of this fuel to the northern side, and the KVA compelling those Grenadiers to pull back. I do think, though, that the Scout Snipers were more the heralds of that particular retreat. But while the Soviets are in the north, we will see down here in the south, these Grenadiers are picking up land, and this mortar is facing the wrong way. So that's great, great opportunities for the Wehrmacht today. Zisk guns are going to troop on forwards. They have that gun line kind of moseying forward and moseying back and moseying forward and moseying back. They realize that there's not a lot of great fire lanes for them, which is surprising considering how open this lower area really kind of is. A single anti-tank gun could handle most of these approaches by facing out from this direction here. Unfortunately, that's not to be. Meanwhile, in the north, we are going to see the P4, the more vetted up P4, pushing back these combat engineers, taking off a model or two. Not that much necessarily being done. In the meantime, a TM-35 mine going down from Panzer Grenadier right by one of these garrisons. KVA charging on forwards. I don't know if he realizes that he's going to get caught out. Yes, these penal troops are healed to put some pressure onto the P4s, but yeah, two heavy tanks indeed. You heard that those tanks... tank drivers right there being, hey guys, we're basically outgunned here. Maximum doing some good damage against this pack and might be able to decrew it. Yes, there he does. And it comes in incendiary barrage as well. It's a surprising decision because his troops will take some damage from this. You can see that happening. They get burned to death, his own troops. So clearly Panzer Grenadier does not care quite so much about his own comrades. Almost getting taken out completely here. this gun's really, really far forward, trying to put some pressure onto these P4s. I don't think that's the greatest option for him. It is worth noting that these Grenadier squads are a little bit out of position to come forward and deal with the anti-tank material, especially with a Maxim right in front. So we're beginning to see the Soviets perhaps finding their rhythm here, up just a couple of tickets, but not taking into that final structure yet. But I believe that I was correct when I was suggesting the Panzer Grenadier is just going to sit and play with his Collins. Now, if Jove can manage to take out one and or both of these anti-tank guns, these can be gravy. The problem is getting to that particular moment. The mortar team still, the German mortar team is getting tons of work done here. How many kills did that thing have? 11. It's going to get some more before this day is out, I imagine. In the meantime, Jove is going to be calling in another pack, as well as building a Stug and another Pioneer. So he's definitely feeling like he's behind a little bit in terms of these repairs on his tanks, and it's hard to really disagree with him on that one. Rifle grenade at all? No, just the rifle fire, enough to compel that machine gun to back away. No, he's not going to call that Stug in. Instead, Jove is going to start the troop forwards. He's going elite troops doctrine for that Tiger Ace. Now, the problem with that is that he's got to get another couple of hundred manpower in before he calls that. But the second he's got that, I mean, that KV-8 is not going to be able to stand up to it. Dead Grenadier squad falling down right in front of us here, and that's unfortunate. Falling for the fatherland is always a noble death, but not something you want to see anyway. It is worth commenting that a lot of the Panzer Grenadier, I think, is very, very good off the mainline attack. But moving to either of the other sides, he's very, very reactive. The Germans push to the south. They take the south, and finally, eventually, a squad goes down to decap, maybe attempt to recap. A tank goes up to the north. And is there an immediate, any kind of, you know, deflection on that? No, there is not. Instead, it's just a kind of a later, much, much later push to deal with that kind of devastating push. Now let's think about this for a second. So 26 command, army slots. So Jove has to either lose something else or have an under strength squad or two. I'm not sure which way he's going to go with that one. But nevertheless, where are we in the game state there, folks? So 264 to 304. The Germans are threatening a decap in the middle part of the field, but that's not going to happen, as this Maxim prevents any infantry from approaching, and between these two Zis guns and that rather undergunned KV-8, we could see a difficult position to crack. I am worried a little bit as well. I'm worried that these Zis guns are going to completely and totally make any push by these Panzer IVs, not obsolete per se, but very, very difficult to say the least. Pack, in the meantime, is going to throw some rounds downrange at this KV-8. Going to do some... Oh, wow, not doing anything whatsoever. Apparently that KV-8 is more finely armored than I gave it credit for. And it looks like... No. Okay, well, KV-2 is going to be... Excuse me, IS-2 will be imminent. And there we go. And now the Germans have to be a teensy bit scared. Has to be more than a little bit scared, actually, I would argue. So the pack, after firing 4 or 5 rounds, is finally get some penetration onto that KV-8, pounding the same area over and over again. And I don't know if this... Wait, is the sniper shooting on forward to get rounds off at the scout snipers, or at... I don't know if he's even trying to shoot for that one. Well, we will see in the meantime, though, that there are several squads that are getting up to full veterancy on both sides. Scout snipers are charging on in, and he's going to get away before the other round comes back out. IS-2 is on the field, though, between the IS-2 and the KV-8. And now, here comes the Tiger Ace. Okay, so I was going to say it was going to tip into the favor of the Russians, but that is an awfully scary force on the German side of things. We will probably see this Grenadier squad die, which is going to just break my heart, because he's got full veterancy right there. But if a squad or two trades its life while taking down this IS-2, it's not going to be easy to be replaced, but at the same time, if he takes it down now, he could have a nice armor advantage for the immediate future. Pac-40 is not going to scratch the armor on that thing. The Tiger Ace maybe, but the Monitor versus the Merrimack, these guys are going to slug it out for a bit of time. And wait, let me think about this for a second. So yeah, he's got the whole pretty greater frequency. Ooh, wow, the pack is actually doing some damage to it. I'm super surprised at that. You don't often see that. Of course, the first round comes in for the Tiger Ace, and that's how you know things are going to be rough. But the IS-2 fires back and hits the house. So we're seeing the behemoths firing back and forth, doing a little bit of damage to each other, but not that much. Never mind, there goes the machine gun. Is he going to take it out? Yeah, he's going to shoot at that machine gun and destroy it, I imagine. They're going to pop the hatch and just jump out for a second. Looked kind of funny for me. One more round will do it. And that's one. Now the KVA is charging on four. It's going to completely and totally wreck this pack crew. And there it goes. And indeed, he's trying to pick on this MG42. And I don't know who is going to win this particular engagement. Because the IS-2 is back into play as well. So it looks like everyone just wants to beat on this Tiger Ace. And if that Tiger Ace goes down, that is a big loss for the Germans. And there goes the KV-8. Okay, that's a big loss right there. And these charging support from the Soviets, this one Ziskun's been completely decrewed now. Excuse me, no, that was the captured pack. Yikes, forgive me on that one there, folks. Now everyone, the mother's going after this Tiger Ace as hard and as long as possible. Oh, jeez, and here comes the incendiary barrage as well. So looking to pick on somebody, anybody if possible. IS-2, though, is here. Mortar squad's going to get taken out. There it goes. Decrewed. And I believe this Tiger Ace is going to get 86'd as well. There he goes. He's gone. And there's no other one to be found. So now Panzer Grenadier has a crazy, crazy advantage on the battlefield, especially as he takes out another Panzer IV. So with three anti-tank guns and this bad boy right here, who still, for some reason, has secure mode, which I think is ridiculous. The Germans take a huge, huge set of losses to the bottom line. So the battle space that had been so recently a little bit more blue is now quite red. This knife coming through the middle, penetrating their defenses on nearly every front. And yep, the Soviets have finally lost their scout snipers, but you know what? Considering some of the stuff they've gained and how easily they can bring in other heavy tanks, I'm not too concerned for their immediate prospects. Now, if we find more of the Soviet infantry keeps falling, that's going to be a bit more of an issue here. I don't know if that's going to be the case. We will see the Germans take back the northern VP and start to get some tickets back in their favor. But that's not 100% just yet. Of course, with dead scout sniper teams, this will give the German sniper free reign around the battlefield. The question is whether or not he's going to use them aggressively to really take care of them. Yikes, IS-2 is right there, and this guy's not going to want to be around for the ire of that giant. He does have a fair amount. Wait a second, he should be able to call in stormtroopers and maybe even pick up a Shrek or two. But I guess it is kind of not the most efficient usage of munitions. It's also not the most efficient use of firepower, throwing rounds into a tank when there's infantry right next to it that would be much more easily gunned down. But as it passed the 34-minute mark, the Soviets, who I thought were on their way towards a defeat, have pulled a very, very, you know, I wouldn't say completely optimistic, but at least a very neutral game out of what seemed to be a very, very negative position. Yes, I'm saying very an awful lot, so, you know, I'm sure there's going to be one of you guys out there who's going to make fun of it. Just you wait. But probably going to be Williams, for that matter. Second KV-8 being called in. While Jove is going to be going for another Shug. And this is the moment that I think to myself, was elite troops really the best usage of commander? Like, I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, if only he had decided to go for that mechanized assault, he could be calling in another Tiga. And he would be calling it another Tigo. Just you wait. KV in the meantime, though, taking a couple of rounds from the Stromgeschütz and being forced back. What we're not seeing, though, is we're not seeing any kind of real long-term plan for the center part of the map. And the Reds will be taking back this position imminently. But another Stug is on the map. We're going to see a third Stug. Maybe three assault guns and a P4 might be enough to dislodge this monster. But KB-8 is charging on forward, so the question is, will this machine gun stay alive long enough in that fiery, burning hell? And he can. He can, it seems. Now, the question is, will the KV-8 survive? And that's a little bit harder to tell. Dear God, look at this mess of troops and tank guns, though. This is a crazy, crazy ball of death. I'm wondering, would Jove be well served by picking up a Panzerwaffe of some kind? I mean, that would be requiring him to tech up, wouldn't it? Ostman might be interesting. It's not going to last a second against something like the IS-2. But just circle strafing around and just with all of his, with all of those anti-tank guns practically on top of each other, that could be incredibly good. Sniper, in the meantime, is forced back. We're going to see the main gun loader has been injured over on this IS-2. Rounds impacting galore. And the Stromgeschützen are doing a shockingly good job here. Grenadiers coming in behind. We see a brave Death or Glory charge for Faust. I would really hope not, because they're going to get shredded if they do that. We are going to see the mortar get recrewed, which means that these anti-tank gun front is going to get pasted if they're not careful. And as we approach the 37th minute of this game, what do we have? 216 to 214. The anti-tank gun front is moving forward. And the sniper is doing a little bit of work here. It's not going to be enough to make a massive difference, at least immediately. Surprised this mortar's not been firing off like crazy. And indeed, we are going to see the KV-8 is trundling on forwards yet again. But with the Panzer IV and the Stugs deployed, they should be able to deflect. No, the Panzer IV is otherwise occupied, and it does seem that the Stugs have no problem taking on the KV-8. Super close to taking it out. Neither one seems really content to charge on forwards. No, but here come the anti-tank gun front, and it's moving back on in. Pioneers trundling forward now. No, instead we're just going to see the sniper trying to put headshots in all over the place. Maybe another round? No, he does not. And it's very, very weird to think that there's now a second, or rather a third, KV-8 on this map. It's going to get to a point that it's a kind of critical mass of Soviet personnel, and I think we're hitting that pretty darn soon. Now, the IS-2, he's continuing to have some long-range effectiveness. He's facing the wrong direction. You can see right now his rear armor is out towards the wind, but doesn't seem to affect him too much. Now he kind of thinks better of it and backs into the correct orientation here. But the Germans have themselves a double cap. Might even be able to get a trip cap. No, he's going to back away instead. Stug comes on forward, throws a round down range, gets a little bit of damage done. And a near miss still does, what, 1/6 of his entire damage? That's ridiculous to me. And yet, it happens. But KV-8 number 3 is on the map, so while the IS-2 keeps the regular German tanks occupied, the KV-8 should be able to run around and just blow these guys to smithereens. This one up here has, of course, been hit by either a mine or maybe perhaps a Panzerfaust. I don't know if that's the case. No, not a Panzerfaust, but we have a Stug coming on in. Maybe just put some pressure on said Stug, on said KV-8, and he might be able to take him down. Another Panzer IV is going to be coming out. PTRS penals are coming in. We see another round. Yep, another round's coming down range. We might see the death of this brave, brave Stug. He's got 2 stars of veterancy. And this KV-8 is almost dead. But what's going to happen instead is that these pioneers are going to get walloped. Penals are being entertained by Grenadiers. Grenadiers going to take some damage as well, though. And there they go. They're backing up. Could we see a brave, brave charge? No, we're not going to. They're going to get forced back. And the Germans are now diluting a lot of their power. This Panzer IV, for example, knows that these guys are right here. He should be attacking this area. All your opponent has collected all of his force in one location. You need to be as aggressive yourself. And with these poor grenadiers, they're gonna get burninated. Gonna retreat right there. Good decision. And all of the German armor is either back in base or on the wrong side of the world. KV-8 charging on forward says mortar team might go down, but the KV-8 might buy it in turn. Round being thrown in, donated to the health of that tank. And it does not look like the... No, Panzer IV is still out of position. He's up to the north now. So we have both P4s way out of position. Oh my gosh, here it comes. So here's the massive, massive push. Anti-tank guns moving on forward a la Rommel. While P4 might be able to get a round or two downrange, doesn't hit with the first shot, though, and that's going to be a bad, bad place for him to be. Yeah, Scheisse, indeed, they're definitely shooting at you, guys. There's flame going in every direction. If the infantry company goes down, it won't be an immediate issue for the German forces. In fact, I mean, getting some pioneers on the field might be better than having Grenz. But having some good, solid infantry might be more than a little bit worthwhile. Stoltek is still being repaired. In the meantime, we're going to see the infantry company finally going down. KV-8's trundling to the south, going to put pressure onto this MG, and this P4 is going to get taken out any second. There we go. So, not handling his tanks especially well here, leaving them out to dry. And Jove is up in tickets, but he's down in VPs, and now his armor is severely compromised, I would argue. Still gets charging on forwards, though, deflecting rounds off of both these KV-8s. And if his IS-2 comes forward at all, oh geez, he still has all three of these anti-tank guns. So once again, there's one Stroh getting hammered. He's probably going to go down. One more barrage will do it. There he goes. That's one dead. And with the KV-8 just base diving right here, doing tons and tons of damage, one KV-8 will finally go down, but at what cost? These poor guys are getting destroyed. But the main gun's been destroyed. This is a massive, massive victory for the Germans. Will they see? No, he's not charging with it at all. Instead, the IS-2 is coming forward now, and so while the Germans have deflected one of those massive issues, not following it up to take it out, he's still not able to complete the consolidated victory there. IS-2 in a weird position, not quite dominant, but not quite negative either. P4 is diving on forward, trying to pick up a couple of these anti-tank guns. He should be able to get around both of them before they can fire. Yep, that's one. He's outside all three of them. Oh my gosh, their line of fire is not going to be able to pick up anything. Cohen's just he's circle strafing like crazy. He's dipping, he's dodging. It's like watching Muhammad Ali over here, folks. And with anti-tank guns coming under fire now from infantry, yes, he's getting some damage in. Incendiary rounds coming downrange, so it's going to be a problem for him. No grenadiers getting inside. And another KV-8's being called in. Dear God, there's so many of them. Question is, will we see these squads make it out alive? No, that's one. The enemy is taking what we have secured. Okay, so no. Instead, we have another P4 coming onto the field, and we're just seeing every single... Like, just body shots go lower all over the place. Panzer Grenadier trying hard to hold steady in the face of all this merciless destruction. One last shot from that Sturmgeschütz takes out the other KV-8, but there's still one on the field. That is the newest KV-8 that just went down, but the IS-2 is still here. Question is, with all this 3-to-1 advantage, he might be able to finally take this out. Gunloader's been damaged, and there goes the IS-2. Ladies and gentlemen, we could see that the Germans have a chance once more. Anti-tank guns are back on the field. Undermanned, to be sure, but they could have enough damage to completely take them out. There goes one right there. That's a big victory. Damaged engine, though, on one P4, and now here's a satchel, I'd imagine, that could take out... the satchel was coming from these penals right here, so that was an interesting decision. Not often seen. Now, the question is, can the Germans manage to push these guys back before this LMG gets picked up? And the question to that is, I don't know. What I do know is that this pack over here is just taking out a Stug. Or is that a P4? I can't tell you for sure, folks, but it was mean, and it was blue, and got brewed up right quick. Try to see if we can get a look inside that. Nope, can't really quite see it. One of our AT guns has been neutralized. And now that captured pack gun is back among the ranks of the uncrewed. Now, the Germans can pick themselves up some very, very nifty amounts of fuel here. They have one, two-ish. It's a couple of wrecks around here, I would argue. Three-ish? Nah, not quite. All right, well, he can definitely pick up some fuel and get himself really back in this. In the meantime, though, we will see stormtroopers popping out over here in the south, picking up both the Jaeger infantry package as well as the anti-tank package, and finally getting some infantry-based AT on the field could be what seals the deal for this resilient German player. Captures this gun is now in the hands of the Germans, but against this KV-8, that might be more of a magnet for negative attention more than anything else, but no, the Stuka has decided to use that awesome, awesome ability. Is that target weak point? Yes, it is. Stuns the crew. Does some good damage as well. We are going to see that the pack crew has been re-emplaced, let's call it. And the Germans are taking the northern VP, even at the same time that they have the southern one firmly in their grasp. So the Germans are slowly getting themselves weaponed back all up. Shrek coming out in just a moment here. And we could see, honestly, a bundle grenade in this area. These guys aren't quick enough to recognize it. Could be incredibly devastating. I didn't appreciate how far forward this piece juts out into the open area. You can see recrewing up here is a great opportunity for them. Now, the Germans, in the meantime, this guy's got 35 kills. He might get picked on pretty darn soon by the charging conscript squad. But these conscripts have an LMG as well, so he could come under firepower, and if he does, that might mean a dead sniper. I could not say for sure off the top of my head. I do also know that these stormtroopers are going to do okay against penal troops, but not if they're vetted up the wazoo that they are. And no, here's a Shrek over to for the penals. That's not what you want to do. Not at this point, friends. Stun grenade goes out. Could we see a dead penal squad? This could be a big turnaround in favor of the Germans. Burst of firepower doesn't pick it up. Grenadiers, pick up this Shrek. And there they go. They get that. It's a 2-0 cap for the moment. Germans are back ahead, finally, in terms of VPs. 2-1 cap now, and this KV-8 is pretty much what Panzer Grenadier is staking his hopes and dreams on for the rest of this match. Now, if I'm the Grenadiers, though, I'm backing up. I have an LMG, and I have a Shrek, and I don't want to lose them, so I'd be backing up right now. There we go. He goes off to base to reinforce and rearm. In the meantime, Boogeyman is on the move. He's got 38 kills, and if he continues to pick on these anti-tank crews, that could be a good win there. And he's going to be doing it as well. These guys are going to continue to get reinforced, but at what cost? Slowly just taking constant bleed. P4 is up here, and with this KV-8, oof, never mind. He's covered now by these anti-tank guns. I would have thought he was going to be able to push forward and really threaten this KV-8, but that is not going to be the immediate opportunity for him. Always wondering about this thing. Yeah, so if it gets infantry, yeah. Patronen. Adorable. And finally, we've seen Panzer Grenadier move down to the southern part of the map, and this is what I was talking about 15 minutes ago in this match, is that while Jove consistently seems to push wherever his opponent is not, we don't see the same thing happening in Panzer Grenadier's troops. Indeed. It seems like he only goes there as an afterthought. Oh my gosh, this could be the dead KV-8. Did he just hit a mine, I believe? Rear armor hit. One more shot should do it. There goes the KV-8. Another Josef Stalin 2 can be called on in. And where's the sniper? 39 kills? Okay, there's another IS-2 coming in. And this might be the last throw of the dice for Panzer Grenadier Angreifen. I will probably see... Will we see a dead retreating conscript squad? One more shot should come in pretty easily. He's got a good... Better range? No, he's not. Okay, never mind. Had he been able to pick that off, that could have been a big win for him, though. Jove, I think, at this point, is holding on to pick up another late-game tank. A P4 might be a good option, if nothing else, than just to kind of, yikes, support his squads a little bit more. And I think there's an MG. Yep, there's an LMG on the field now. Pania's charging on forward. He's going to put some flame. Nope, never mind. I thought he was going to try to put some flame into this penal troop. but not able to do so. Are Germans losing their position to the middle part of the map? We're going to see a artillery barrage? No, we're not. And I'm confused that we haven't seen more usage of the Muni abilities on top of the German troops. There's not a lot of Fausts, not a lot of rifle grenades. Heck, there have been opportunities, I would argue, to upgrade Jaeger infantry packages on all of the troops. LMGs galore, but it's not been happening. We're only finally seeing upgrades happening for both the Pioneer squads. Now, there's still an LMG down to the south, and now a conscript squad with two LMGs, that's a rather good thing for the Soviets, and that a lousy thing for the Germans, and jeez, I hate when that happens. He's lofted a round downrange, and four infantry kills, one round came in, blew apart an entire squad. Isn't that just so frustrating? I think it is, anyway. As we're coming into the, I would hope, is the last part of this game, 51 minutes in, 120 to 120, we're bang on even, the Germans will lose some tickets here. And it's just that constant struggle back and forth. I thought for sure the Russians were out of it earlier on. Then I thought for sure that the Russians were going to win it just even a little bit later than that. Then the Stormtrooper called on in, and that's probably a good thing right there. Get another... Okay, well, Gewehr squad... No, STG is coming in. Ooh, nice. About time. Oh, that'd be so good. I would also... Pushed. No, he's not going to get those. I was going to say push to get that Shrek, but it's either SDGs or it's Shreks. It's not both now, is it? That's unlucky, isn't it? As P4 to the south is going to take some firepower from these bad boys right here. And this is happening yet again. I'm thinking that maybe a Panzerwerfer would have been a good decision to secure Joe's positions against these anti-tank guns. You just want to see one barrage would have plastered two of them at least. And indeed, though, we're going to see Jove stormtroopers charging on in. These guys don't have any more Shreks that have been dropped, unfortunately. We're going to see any kind of... No, wow. So these guys getting a pounding from the rear. His Zisk gun and pack doing some good damage here. And now these conscripts are getting pushed back as well. Is this where the Red Army is starting to fold? I wouldn't say it ain't so, because I'm definitely rooting for the Germans, I won't lie. But this has certainly been seesawing back and forth. Mortar rounds coming in from the German mortar, not quite impacting on the Russian position. But it's a 2-1 cap. It's going to be a 2-0, and then very, very soon after that, a trip cap in favor of the Germans. Rear armor hits happening over here. Well, at least one more round should get off. One more salvo? No, he backs away in time. But these combat engineers realize that they're combat engineers for a reason. Usually, if they were behind enemy lines or behind their own lines, would not be quite so under fire. And interestingly, at 53 minutes into this game, we're going to see shock troops being called on in. And why is that? Well, with the PPSs and the inherent grenades that they do possess, there's definitely a possibility, and a very easy possibility at that, to have the shock troops spill into wherever the opponent is and maybe pick up a easy squad wipe or two. Now, these conscripts right here, they are suppressed right now. Might get pinned just before... One more. There they go. He's going to back up before he captures that position. That's a win for the Germans. 101 to 90 to 88. Excuse me. While the shock troops are pushing down to the south, this is what I'm talking about. Those PPSs make them deadly close infighters. And Joe is going for another P4. So I can't tell you how many P4s that's been. I think it's been at least four, if not five or six. And a Tiger Ace as well. So it's been a very costly battle for the Germans. Luckily for them, it's not an actual fight. Otherwise, dear God, I've been just over for days. Stormtroopers popping that tactical advance thing, so they are much more vulnerable, but they're much more accurate on the advance. Sniper, in the meantime, 47 kills. I think he's leading the match. 13, even with the IS-2, that's a new IS-2 anyway, so not a lot of competition. 48 kills now. He just continues to get more and more damage done, but he might get picked off on retreat. Mine detected down in the south. That's a teller mine right there. Going to keep that IS-2 safer just a little bit longer. And the AT guns are trying to push around to pick up and defend their combat engineers as these guys are shifting forward to pick up against these minefields. But the Pioneers have something different to say about that, and in close firefights, they might be able to bring that up. Meanwhile, the North, we will see Panzer forcing it push back in the face of this IS-2. Another KV-8 was the fifth or sixth one on this map being called in. And this IS-2 was just trooping down the line in front of all this negative attention here. And the Soviet anti-tank guns are right back in the action as well. So both players exchanging body shots. I'm surprised that either one of them has any bit of strength left. You see the artillery barrage called down to the bottom. MG's probably going to go down finally, but instead we're going to see the one anti-tank gun decrewed. In fact, that's the captured pack. But the Zisk gun's coming in as well, so the question is, can the Zisk gun defend this long enough to be retaken? And the answer to that seems to be yes. No, never mind, the pack gets taken out just before it happens. Can this Zisk gun be decrewed? Yes, it can. Maybe a bundle grenade to take it out? No, it's just going to be AT gun rounds to destroy that position for good. Now the shock troopers, half-strength squad, are going to try to face off against these full-strength grenadiers, albeit rather damaged. And the IS-2 convinces them it's probably a better decision to back away towards home base. And this is a brave thing. That's a very brave thing. This Stug, full vet, charging on in to put rounds against this KV-8, maybe just to push him back for the time being. I don't know if that's the best option. Oh, but we have these packs are now set up right behind this house. If they get vision on this IS-2, and they should. No. No, they're not. Huh. That should have been a dead IS-2 in my mind. But it seems the world had a different goal or a different destiny for him today. Meanwhile, this sniper has been called in, what, about the 5th minute, 6th minute? 51 kills. And remember that for the first good chunk of this game, his only job was to do scout sniping. He was just there to counter-snipe the entire game, and really well played to Joe for that. Now, Panzer Grenadier, I feel it's kind of like Viktor Navorsky in this map right now. He's kind of like, he's trying to get from here to here, and that's not happening at the moment. Indeed, we're seeing the sniper coming in, throwing down a round against this mortar team and then backing away. This thing is a little bit expensive, but it stuns, and that's always a good solid opportunity there. KV-8, though, going to come at right in front of this anti-tank position again. And that's the kind of thing that leads to a dead KV-8. Oh my gosh, I don't think he's going to get away from this one. The Stug comes in, blasts him to pieces, and he is out, folks. IS-2 charges back in. No, he's not going to want to do that. He's not going to want to do that. Pack has him in range, deflects the first round, though. That thing is awfully thick skin. And combat engineers just kind of hanging out, all of them. It's just like the pit crew of anti-tank positions. How quickly can we repair our biggest tank possible? And the Germans are having their own pit crew opportunities. Meanwhile, in the south, though, we're going to see Pioneers and Stormtroopers trying to push back, successfully, it seems, at least immediately, these Soviet capturing squads. Meanwhile, okay, that teller mine never got picked up. The IS-2 is open. Will the P-4s charge in after that? That's a good question right there. What needs to happen is they need to harry his combat engineers as much as possible. They would never get a better opportunity to pick off the IS-2. Going to see one P-4 swing around from the west. Seeing the Stug coming up the middle. And we've seen the other P-4 swing around from the east. This could be a dead IS-2, folks. This gun is in here, but guys, this is the only option he's really going to get to take this guy out. Rounds coming in. P4 throwing down shade. Deflecting rounds, though. No, this could be the biggest chance he's got. This is really the only chance he's got. 92 to 39. Let's get a little bit different of a view here. Snipers coming in behind, trying to put pressure maybe on these repairing combat engineer squads. Could not say for sure. But watch them start to go down. Oh my gosh, he's just bouncing rounds like crazy. AT guns for both sides back in base. If the Germans had any AT to use right now, actually, heck, drop a group of stormtroopers in this house and pull out a Shrek on them, and that'd be a great opportunity right there. But no, it seems the Germans are going to be able to take a double cap and maybe even a momentary trip cap. Yes, definitely going to be a momentary trip cap. Incendiary barrage coming down as well, so maybe these guys are going to finally perish. But this is going back and forth, folks. We might see the dead crews. They're getting plastered. Never mind that. They're retreating. As is that machine gun? I don't know. Sniper is finally dead, though. That guy was a god among mortals. 92 to 16. Unless the Soviets can take out... this position at any moment soon, it's not going to... It's not going to go well. This IS-2 is charging on forwards. 92 to 10 as we're crossing the hour minute mark. 10 tickets left. The Germans are starting to lose squads like crazy, though. 92 to 7. There goes one P4. Pack and the Zisk gun are both firing like crazy onto this IS-2. And IS-2 backs away. The Germans just have to take one of these positions for just a couple of seconds here. But another KV-8 being called in, which means that it's going to be very difficult to take that position. Might be a dead combat engineer. Really should be. Stormtroopers in the meantime being called on in. These guys need Shreks. No, they're going to go for STGs instead. Looking to take that last little chunk of anti-infantry and not managing to do so. So 92-3. This is definitely a nail biter, folks. Panzer Grenadier Angreifen is not saying die, and neither should you guys. If you want the Russians to win, I'm gonna hear it right now. Shock troops gonna get pinned and probably suppressed and pinned rather easily. I always say that backwards. I don't know why. KV-8 trying to defend to the north. And the Stug is swinging up there instead. So 87-3, the Germans are losing tickets here now. And I don't know how this one is going to end. PTRS, Penals coming on up to the top of this map. And we're just seeing... Okay, MG-42 doing some good damage here against these combat engineers. And one of the squads has gone down. Now, once pinned... So we can take out these repairing squads, that'd be a massive victory unto itself. No, he can't, though. Indeed, looks like it's going to be a trip cap for the Russians. But it won't be easy, folks. Instead, we are going to see a charging KV-8 might lose his life for the good of the motherland. There he goes. That's one dead right there. Another vehicle has been lost in the defense of he's just keep trying to emphasize how many vehicles have gone down, and I can't say I blame him. Being on the north... Going to see stormtroopers facing off against penals. A rather judicious usage of maybe a bundle grenade would be a good idea here. He's got the munis for it. It's expensive, but he can get another one in another minute. He's charging on in. He's doing it. He's coming in closely, and his PTRSs are a little bit slower in terms of fire. He's going to take one position back. IS-2 down in the south, though, is going to be trying to take out these pioneers. These guys are brave beyond all measure. Inside this house, I don't want this mill to get blown to pieces, but I think that might be what happens to it. Those poor, poor Dutch farmers. And indeed, here come the stormtroopers to actually push back this mortar team as well. Could we see a pickup of either anti-tank crew or mortar team? Well, we will see at least a 2-1 cap? I don't know. IS-2 is going to take out one of its tormentors. The Germans are going to take the middle part of this position, and the STGs are trying to do their work. They're deadly... Deadly business continues. Zisk gun is going to get taken out here. There's no way he's going to get back from this one. Meanwhile, the IS-2 is diving deep behind enemy lines, charging on in like there's no tomorrow. And it's 25-3 right now, folks. One more round, one more rear... Okay, rear armor hit. This question, can the P-4 take it out? Will the Yosef Stalin 2 takes out one? That's one dead right there. Is the Stroh going to come on in? He is... He's got him under his guns. One more round. Oh my god, he's not going to get the round off. The IS-2 is going to get it. IS-2 picks him off. Ziskun not getting him under fire. And now the Germans, it's 18 to 3. If the Germans can take this southern VP, it will be all over. Germans just throwing all the bodies they can at the middle VP just to hold it off. And I think this is going to finally be a German victory. 1 hour, 4 minutes. Germans are taking the northern VP, and that's going to be all it, folks. That desperate, desperate struggle, that is all she wrote. Jove finally takes out Panzer Grenadier Angreifen. And wow, what a game. 1 hour, 4 minutes, and 32 seconds from start to finish. And Jove wins by a final score of 18-0. So well played on both sides. Definitely some drops here or there in terms of micro, in terms of the armored vehicles. What eventually happened to that Yosef Stalin? Okay, the Yosef Stalin took out his final tormentor, but it seems the last round came in before that happened. And this battlefield pretty much tells it all. The number of wrecked vehicles on here is just devastating. But folks, thank you so much for staying with me through that marathon of a game. Ridiculous, ridiculous finish, I would argue. That's going to be it for me today, and I need a bit of a break myself just to kind of get myself back onto an even keel here. But that's going to be Con Ulrich signing off. Thank you so much, folks. I'll talk to you all soon. Take it easy. Have a